Welcome to the Mischief. I'm Vallen, and this is Tinker's Construct. This I'm going to be calling the Tasty Update. So there have been a few updates to Tinker's Construct, and I thought that I might go over them to get you guys up to speed with some of the changes. Now, these didn't just happen yesterday or anything. These happened a little bit ago, and I just finally have gotten around to it. I've been a little bit busy. But anyway, let's get into it. We've got a brand new tool slash weapon slash whatever you want to use it. It is the comma, as you can see here. And no, it's not a comma as in like grammar. I have a few options here that I can choose from. Actually, here, let me just grab these and I'll put them on my hotbar. And you can see I have a regular old wooden comma. How to create one of these is actually in your standard tool station. So this is an early level thing. You can't make a scythe, but it's kind of like a scythe, kind of not. It's like a cross between a smaller scythe area as well as what you call a pair of shears, perhaps. And it is made with a comma head, a binding, and some kind of tool rod. So it's a really basic recipe. You can make one very early game, and it's going to be good. The attack speed on it's 1.3, so it's a little bit slower than a sword, a little bit faster than an axe. And of course, I've got some other ones here to show these. So if I use this wooden one here, you can see I can actually harvest a bunch of just goods, and they get replanted automatically, just like a scythe would. But it's a single block, so I'm not actually doing any others, but it is really, really nice like that. And you know, like I said, it's an okay weapon. It's nothing really spectacular, but if you get bugged by something while you're harvesting your goods, then obviously you do have a little bit of offensive options. Now, if you notice here, I have a firewood comma that is set up with auto smelt. So if I use it, I can actually harvest and get cooked potatoes from this, but you'll notice that it does not replant, because it actually uses the items that are brought up to kind of replant those. And of course, if you have this with like some insane speed, you can just like run around here. You can even use it on sugarcane. It won't actually cut the last of the sugarcane, but it's really good. I gotta say, it's pretty darn cool. It works as intended, as the as it says on the box there. But it does have some other benefits. If you notice here, I have some sheep eggs that I'm going to put on the ground. Let's bring in a few sheepies here, and you can see that I can, when I right click, harvest them just like a pair of shears. It doesn't matter if it's a wooden pair or if it's whatever, it just works as a pair of shears. Now, it does not till ground or anything like that. I tried doing this, it ends up trying to dig the ground instead. Right clicking doesn't do anything. So it's a harvest and replant tool. Plus you can use it to shear sheep or things of that nature. You can even use it in things like a tree. So if I just left click there, I get the shears or the sheared version back of these tree leaves. So it's really cool. I could actually make myself practically a wooden version of shears out of this instead of having to go to something with iron or anything like that. So your early game needing to harvest grass or leaves or anything like that for any reason is very easy to do, and it doesn't need to cost you any kind of iron per se. Now, of course, you can make it go really crazy. You can use yourself, like I've got this cobalt one, and it's hooked up pretty good with a lot of redstone and crazy mining speed levels. You can always expand this with your expander bonuses as well, so that you can get a 2x2 area instead of just a one block area with it as you're harvesting either trees, grass, or replanting, things like that. So it's pretty cool. It works really nice. But enough about the comma. There are other things in this update that should be covered, and that is the channel, the return of the channel. And I don't mean a YouTube channel. In fact, here, let me just take this and get out of here. Okay, so I have casting channel, I should say, is made simply with a bunch of searing brick. You get one of these little pots here. And how do they work? Well, that's what I'm going to show you. There we go. I just needed to empty out my inventory. I now have some casting channels. First, you can place one down on the ground. You're going to want to, if you want to pick them back up, you just mine them like you would regularly with any kind of pick or anything. You notice that it kind of has this slanted look to it. Place it down, it looks like a little bowl. Well, if you right click on the side, with either an empty hand or just something that's not another casting channel, it should kind of try and connect to nearby blocks. Now, if I just place this by itself and I right-click, it's not going to do anything because there's nothing for it to actually connect to. In this case, I've got a bunch of channels all together. So it kind of functions like liquid fluid ducts or some kind of water transportation or just fluid transportation. I'm using water in this example, but it can be also very good. Now, if you notice, it says disallowed flowing on side. Set side to flow outwards. Set side to flow inwards. So you can change the direction that the fluid is flowing just by right-clicking a little bit on the sides that you want it to actually do so. And if you want to, you can just click it a few times and, you know, break them apart. They will hold a little bit of fluid in each one. And you can also have them connect below. Now, if you notice here, above this water, I currently have this little kind of downward area here. If I right-click in the middle, that goes away, disallowed flowing down. So you can actually have it flow down. You can have it flow on top of itself as well. So if I put it on top, I could actually put a bunch of these here. Shift right click will allow me to place on top of it. Then I could have them flow down through them into others and flowing onward. So it's a way of transporting fluids without having to have them go down into seared gauge from faucet to faucet, or having to use an external mod for this purpose. So I have 4 buckets of water in this seared gauge. I have 3 buckets of water already in all of the other ones here, and they're already set up to currently pour down. The reason that I have this set up is because it will go to the first downward spout and stop until that one's full, and then it will actually, it's smart like this, it will go to the next one if there's more down the line. For instance, you can see here, it's currently flowing into the first tank. Once that first tank is empty or is filled up, then it's going to continue because it's on there, going to the next tank and flowing down and so on. Now, if I stop this in the middle, it will actually just kind of drain out because there's no space there. If I disconnect this and pour it, you'll notice that there's a little bit of liquid stuck in each one. So that's something to keep in mind there. You're going to want to probably, you know, get this working properly before you figure out which way you want to go. I had that facing the wrong way when I broke it, my bad. So there we go. And it's easy to just right-click and turn the channels in the wrong flowing direction, which is what I just did there. And that's why they weren't actually flowing as intended. And once this is all complete, it should go around and fill all those ones. Now, what is this for? Well, it's just a way of transporting your fluids, as I was saying. But you can also get really crazy with some of this stuff. Which I will actually use my next topic we're going to talk about to demonstrate some of this. Pig iron. Pig iron has had a big rebalance, as well as some of the other ones. But pig iron, I think, is the biggest change in my mind. You notice probably that I am mostly injured on my hotbar down below. I have a tasty, bacon-licious little bow here, little pig iron paper short bow, tasty bacon-licious, writable too. It's really fast, but watch my food meter. Oh my gosh, wow, it's like I'm instantly eating it. I'm eating it very quickly. Now this one is unbreakable right now because I added writable limbs to it, but it's really, really effective at feeding you. So it will destroy durability of tools if they don't have a lot of durability on them. If you're holding it as before, with Baconlicious and Tasty, etc., if you're using it to mine things or whatever, you may produce bacon as well, and therefore need those to eat. Or you could just hold the tool and automatically eat from its durability. And as this one's unbreaking in this case, I have a permanent food source and never really have to worry about that again as long as I'm holding this bow or any other pig iron tool like this. I have a tasty one here that is also unbreakable and so on. But it is strong already in that manner, but it is much faster to feed you, as well as, you know, here I'm going to show you, you can use this to like do some casting as well of different ingots and so on. So there you go, just to give an example, and little bits left in there. You can see that there's 1.8 buckets left in here. I had 2 buckets worth, and it's correct because you can make 4 ingots out of each one. And it just drained what was in the tube, or in the casting channel into there and did a partial ingot. If I click this again, it's going to continue on and still have some remnants left in the channel. So it is something that you're going to want to watch out for, that you don't just leave that stuff in there. But just the same, let's see, I've got some notes on the side here. The recipe has changed. That was it. The blood amount that you needed before plus emeralds made this thing a high tier weapon or material, and it didn't really compete very well with those. And now it's a mid tier, meaning it's pretty darn good by itself, and it doesn't require much at all. It only requires, I believe, 40 millibuckets. If I look up pig iron here, the recipe is now 144 millibuckets of molten iron, 40 millibuckets of blood, and 72 millibuckets of molten clay. No more emeralds. That's right. It's gated behind clay, which is even worse to find than emeralds. No, I'm kidding. But you get the idea here. You put these together, you get yourself a bunch of molten pig iron, and you can make yourself your tools, which, in my opinion, pig iron makes really good ranged weaponry with your base Tinker's Construct. But it also can make permanent food sources for you and is quite excellent. So if you are looking at this massive smeltery, you probably notice that I am missing some parts. I don't have a face to it. I'm going to show another part of that as well, and that is that I need the smeltery controller. And let me just mine this bit up here, put this down, and actually grab that. There we go. Put this down, and it now has 5 locations in it. This is going to demonstrate multiple things. One, it's going to demonstrate the casting channels. Let's start this flowing, which there you go. Your molten iron is going into the smeltery drain, which is filling up inside. And then I'm also adding in the clay, and then I'm also going to add in a bit of blood, and therefore I'm making myself molten pig iron, which is really, really cool. You can make these really interesting effects with the channels now. But there's other stuff. Now, you notice in here it's making the molten pig iron. It's going to run out and so on. But what one of the big changes has happened as well is that you no longer need to have a smeltery controller on the bottom. Now, yes, I did just destroy the contents inside there. But if you look up here, I'm going to break this block at the top, and I'm going to fly up here because I'm in creative now, place down the block, and oh, look at this. It now has a smeltery, and there was a little bit of iron still going in there, but look, I have all 5 left, and the smeltery goes down. It can now go up to 64 blocks tall with the controller and still detect the entire smeltery itself, as long as it's part of the structure. And look, we've got our lava supply down on the bottom, and it's not on the same level as that. So there's been some really good improvements to the smeltery for Tinker's Construct. No longer are you reliant on having it on the base level and then building up from there. You can actually have it higher and build it down into the ground if you so desire, which I think is a really, really nice touch. Now, enough about the Baconlicious tools or tasty tools that I have here. Let's talk about some of the other changes. I currently have here some aquamarine. Aqua Dynamic now it always works, and it automatically will just give a damage boost instead of with lessened durability. It now will automatically give a little bit of a damage boost and the damage increase with less durability. On top of that, cactus tools and weapons will always return damage and more when blocking. So if I have some monsters here, let's get some spiders, throw these guys out here. Oh, that one's gonna die. And I have a battle sign with an embossment of spiky. So if I use this to defend, it will always, let's poke this guy here, do that spiky damage. And you can see the little green hearts causing that. Here, I'm going to poke this guy here. There we go. Hit him. And you can see the little green hearts hitting him every single time instead of a chance of it. And they do a bit more damage, I believe, as well. Or more damage when blocking. So just holding this. Actually, let me place this guy down here. Poke him. I'm not going to block. You can see he's going to take some spiky damage. If I wasn't holding something that was flammable, that's actually a really bad idea. Let me grab this, which is going to be a little bit better. Place down this guy, poke him. I've got a Manilan broadsword, and you can see he's taking spiky damage. I'm not defending. I can't defend with this broadsword. And he takes that spiky damage because it is spiky. So even without defending, it will still do some damage to your opponents. On top of that, we've got some other things. As you're seeing, flammable now works when not getting hit and not when blocking. So that basically, if you are getting hit or even when you're blocking and you have the flammable option on there, then you can set your enemy on fire, which I pretty much demonstrated with that previous spider. I wasn't blocking and he was still being set on fire. And last but not least, we've got our netherrack tools. The non-nether mob damage that this does, previously it would do 2, to a non-nether mob. It will now do 4, which is equivalent to 2 bonus hearts. So therefore, it works on tools and blades very well, in fact. And you can do just by using those, you can make yourself some really good netherrack tools that will do extra damage to non-nether mobs. And that's pretty much it. I mean, I realize that there's not a lot here is for me to like cover an entire mod, but sometimes I find just having a big update like this, I mean, I consider this a pretty big update. This is very substantial to me. It changed, it did a lot of rebalancing. There were even some metals and stuff that were not part of Tinkers. Vanilla Tinkers, I should say, the more like modified Tinkers that adds in like Electrum and Lead and stuff. Those have been changed as well. But I think that this was really, really cool with changing a lot of the functionality abilities and some of the new weapon and tool that you have there, which can really help you out early game. So if you guys enjoyed this video, please be sure to give a like, comment, subscribe, and as always, be sure to spread the mischief to others if you think they'll enjoy this content too. And until next time, folks, I'll see ya.